published 6:02 Eastern Standard Time, the 25th of January 2018, updated 6:21 Eastern Standard Time, the 25th of January 2018. Surely you can find some decent Ugandan marimba music. Engagebrain, Cape Town. As one of the country's leading sports journalists, one of the questions I am most frequently asked is, surely you can find some decent Ugandan marimba music, and I always reply, what do you think this column is, mate? Just an outlet for me to post increasingly obscure corners of my record collection, loosely tied together with some chat about sport. 5 points up next, after some Angolan marimba music. Point 1, charity begins at home. Everton, in company with Barcelona, are the only clubs in world football to have created and support an ex-players foundation to help former players. In addition, Everton's foundation is looking after Tommy Smith, the former Liverpool fullback. Stuart, Merseyside. Maybe they should pump money into local communities and reduce ticket prices. Footballers can pay to support themselves. Freddie Bus 007, United Kingdom. The players helped by Everton's foundation were those who played long before the Premier League was formed. As for supporting local communities, Everton's players go out regularly to local hospitals and charity organisations to provide support and encouragement for their work. Perhaps you should do a little research first before berating clubs. Stuart, Merseyside. Or even think beyond what clubs do for you. Stuart helpfully responded to last week's debate column, in which Manchester United's payment of millions in agents' fees was juxtaposed with a plight of former player Nobby Styles, by pointing out the impressive work being done at Everton. Immediately, he was shot down by a demand for reduced admission instead. In other words, what can the club do for me? What use is helping former players to me? Running a football club is a delicate balancing act. Most businesses have one bottom line, profit. But a football club also has the complication of achieving success, or at least not being relegated. Then, there is the increasing demand to behave in a charitable way towards former players and communities, but also to provide cheaper deals for existing customers, evidenced by campaigns such as 20's Plenty. I'm not saying they meet all of these demands, but they are there. So clubs are expected to stay in profit, to buy big players but not spend on agents, to maintain success, look after former members of staff and cut prices. And, even if they do, it is unlikely they will please everybody. People think it's easy to run a football club. It's not. Point 2, about the good old days. You can lay all this greed and disloyalty at the door of Sky. It has destroyed British football. Sparky 666, Ormskirk. I disagree, partly. Football was destroying itself long before the start of the Premier League. Growing up supporting Hull, we would see our owners in their flash Jaguars with fat cigars while Booth Ferry Park was becoming more derelict each season. I naively went along to paint it to help the club, yet never saw the owners dip in their pockets because they were happy to let it plod along while taking money out every year to fuel their family holidays. Prices went up, but I rarely recall any major transfers that weren't subsidized by player sales. All the money left the sport, too. However, since the founding of the Premier League, almost every club gets a hefty chunk of cash, but the bigger ones take more than is healthy. They are worse than Sky, and the Football Association are toothless for not stopping it. Tim C. Hull, I agree, largely, with Tim here. It is so easy to blame all of football's ills on money and the modern game, forgetting that in the 1950s, say, we had full stadiums and a maximum wage. So where did all that money go? At least you can see where it is being spent now, on the player earning £200,000 per week, on his £50 million transfer fee, on the money to the agent to broker the deal, on the new stadium, on the new academy. Hear players from the 1960s talk about training ground facilities in the old days, before sports science and the vast overheads of the modern complex, and ponder where that money went, too. A director at West Ham used to regale the bar at the local golf club with how well the business was run. "I've never had to put my hand in my pocket," he would say. "Yet my father did, for his season tickets. At least you know what you are paying for now, even if you might not agree with it." The game has changed since the days when Hull City called Booth Ferry Park their home. Point 3, about Newcastle takeovers, Mike Ashley and Cockneys. I had a chat with Mike Ashley when I bumped into him near his villa in Mallorca. He came across well and was honest about his need to sell Newcastle to someone with the money to help the club grow. No point selling to Amanda Staveley if she hasn't got big money backers. Fisherman 53, North Wales. The difference in the Amanda Staveley takeover is considerably more than £50 million. She wants a much heavier reduction on the price and will no doubt carry the club for a few years, then make a quick profit from another buyer. I'm siding with Mike Ashley even though he has been a constant, undermining force regarding the club. Goffa Goffa, Toronto. Ashley is the owner and he put Newcastle United up for sale. His price of £350 million is too high, otherwise the club would already be sold. I do not see buyers lining up at that price. When he takes a loss, it is because Ashley does not know the football business. Bingzola, Columbus. I don't think Ashley claims to know the football business. I think he's quite shocked by it actually. I, too, had a chance meeting with him, in the director's box at Watford, and he was also very frank about the problems facing Newcastle and the mistakes he has made. One of his observations is that football is unlike other industries. In any other field, as he sees it, if you put £90 million into the business, you see direct results of that investment. Football was alone in that, having spent £50 million on players, say, an owner will then be told, well, that hasn't worked, we need another £50 million. And he's right there. Manchester United spent £75 million on Romelu Lukaku, now Jose Mourinho has gone back to the board and told them they need to spend again on Alexis Sanchez. They probably thought the £75 million had addressed that particular problem, but, no. I don't think Ashley has been the best and I'd say he probably acknowledges that, too. But I do think it is his right to set the price and not be bounced into a cut-and-run deal by an investment group that is showing little sign of having the necessary funds. To bid £250 million isn't a crazy low offer. That's your statement collapsed. FWEPC, Chelsea. It is if the man who owns the club has no pressing need to sell and wants £350 million. In normal takeovers, a premium is offered to the shareholders to tempt them. Ashley is the shareholder here, and values his shares at £350 million. Offering to buy at a substantial discount doesn't seem a good tactic unless you know for a fact the seller is in financial distress. That doesn't seem to be the case here. I think most people would agree Ashley is an unlovely man whose stewardship of Newcastle has been cynical and money-orientated. That being said, it doesn't necessarily follow that literally anyone else would be better. I can't see any reason for thinking that PCP Capital Partners would make significant improvements to the club other than by increasing debt in the short term, with the risks being medium to long term. The huge concern is surely that Rafa Benitez will tire of them all and get out. Ian Lewis, Northampton. Indeed, but he might do that either way, due to the limitations of Newcastle as a club. While his career path may have obstacles here, he could be presented with a better opportunity abroad this summer, takeover or not. The problem is that people are confusing wanting to sell with having to sell. Ashley wants to sell. That doesn't mean he has to, if the price is not right. He isn't in financial distress, as Ian points out, so sets the price at what he considers a fair return for him. Considering that he spent £263 million acquiring the club, and English football is generating more money than ever before, of course £250 million is low. Amanda Staveley's bid for Newcastle is short of what Mike Ashley wants to sell for. Ashley is the villain. The problem here is that fans of other clubs and southern-based journalists haven't a clue about Newcastle United or its fans. I keep hearing he cleared the debt. Well, he bought the club, so it is his to clear. This man fired Sam Allardyce, he fired Chris Hughton when 11th in the league, following promotion. We have been relegated twice on his watch, after our time in the Premier League had seen European football, including Champions League, and top two finishes and cup finals. He has abandoned the team and club progression for what? The chance to sell. So sell and leave us to people who may give us a chance to progress. Believe nothing that comes out of St. James Park. It will be a lie, it always is. Don't just accept that the bidder hasn't played ball. CC 72, Newcastle upon Tyne. I can step on a train at King's Cross and be in the centre of Newcastle in less than 3 hours. Yet the city, the club and its supporters are a mystery to us all down here. What rubbish. You're not special. None of us are special. We're a tiny little island that can be traversed, top to bottom, in an afternoon. Your love of football and your club is no different to that felt by the supporters of, say, Southampton or Bristol City. and the idea that the South does not understand a passion for football is risible given the numbers, average attendance at Newcastle this season 52,006. And that's admirable, given Newcastle's recent history. But here's something equally admirable. Average at Tottenham, 65,945. Arsenal, 59,381. West Ham, 56,944. Chelsea is 41,509, but we all know they will sell out a 60,000 capacity stadium when they get one. And on it goes. Crystal Palace 24,812. Watford 20,214. And that's just the Premier League. There are 4 London clubs in the Championship, 3 in Leagues 1 and 2. There are 13 London clubs in all. It was 14, but Leighton Orion fell out of League 2, and if I had to include National League teams, I would also need to find room for Sutton, Bromley, Boreham Wood, Dagenham and Redbridge and Ebbsfleet, watched by on average 342,054 people. And don't think this is just because London is a big place either. It is regionalised. Majority of West Ham's crowd will be from East London and Essex, Arsenal and Tottenham's from North London, going out to Hertfordshire and West Essex, Chelsea from the West and South West, Crystal Palace from the South. London is a collection of 57 small towns and villages, so West Ham, say, do not take from the whole city but its particular corner. If you were born in Erith, say, it's unlikely you will support West Ham. Your team, most likely, will be Charlton. Newcastle United has a city to itself and its environs, so, largely, does Paris Saint-Germain. That London supports close to one-third of all Premier League teams is testament to the feeling for football in the capital. I remember Kevin Keegan saying people in London were more interested in the theatre. It was nonsense then and it's nonsense now. I admire Newcastle fans for sticking by their club through lean times, but West Ham have never won the league, not even in 1927, and look at their crowds. Every club, like every family, thinks it is special, meaning no club is. And the fact that Cockney is seen as an insult on Tyneside and advanced, in itself, as one of the reasons Ashley should not run the club, or why Alan Pardew was a bad manager, is perhaps one of the reasons the fans do not have the wider influence on media that they desire. As for Newcastle's record prior to Ashley, it was certainly better, but not the cavalcade of brilliance you make out. The top two finishers, for instance, were in 1995-96 and 1996-97, while the Champions League campaigns amount to 3 appearances, one of which ended in the pre-qualifying round, the other two in the first and second group stage. FA Cup finals, 2, both lost, and neither this century. Indeed, in the decade before Ashley, Newcastle finished 13th, 13th, 11th, 11th, 4th, 3rd, 5th, 14th, 7th and 13th. Average position is 9.4, so 10th. Under Ashley, counting 2 first place finishers in the Championship following relegation as 21st spot, the average finish is 14.8, so 15th. No, it isn't great. But you are comparing an era in which Alan Shearer was the striker to one in which he was, briefly, the manager. Now we can argue that Ashley should have invested more, but you must admit the previous owners caught a break when the best goalscorer in English football spurned bigger and better clubs to return home. And while I may be only a southern journalist who prefers the theatre and couldn't possibly understand Newcastle's unique football culture, at least I didn't have to overlook the presence of Alan Shearer to make my argument work. Kennedy moved from Chelsea to Newcastle this week. It's not that far after Olhoo Samuel goes again. Talking nonsense about a subject he hasn't a clue about. A typical southern journalist looking for any excuse to defend Ashley. Harry, Leicester. Yes, we're all the same down here, as southerners. We all hang around doing southern things, thinking southern thoughts. None of us ever disagree. We're all of one mind in our big southern club. Ashley is from the South, so, naturally, I agree with him. Do you even know how ludicrous your argument sounds? Sorry, Martin, but as a Newcastle fan, you need to see it from our perspective. We have a team not cut out to be in the Premier League because Ashley promised funds to Benitez that didn't materialise. We will be relegated until he invests, see our despair. All we want is for our team to do well and it won't under Ashley. No, we are not business people, but don't forget he's had free advertising at our stadium all these years. Our 93W, Gateshead. Well, I can see you are not a business person, RW, or you would appreciate that it isn't free advertising, because you could sell the space Sports Direct occupies at St. James Park to an outside company. So there is a cost, and even if the projection is better value than it could be taking out similar space elsewhere, it's certainly not free. Also, please don't think you do not have my sympathy. I can see what a good club Newcastle could be. I agree it has not been funded in a way to make it successful. But my job isn't to see subjects in a partisan way. That's why I am not swayed by emotional arguments, or by Staveley's promises in media interviews. People think that to be suspicious of the Staveley takeover is to be in Ashley's camp. But that's not true. I like swift, clean takeovers, because that shows the financial capacity of the new owners. Once stuff drags on, particularly when the parties are significantly apart, I worry. Whatever Ashley's failings, Newcastle will not go under with him in charge, or plunge through several divisions. That is no empty promise. I appreciate no major club has actually gone skint, despite the doom-laden predictions of those supporting financial fair play, but a colossal collapse is not unimaginable. That's why I don't think all investors, or investment groups, are equal. Look at Coventry. Yes, Newcastle have been relegated twice under Ashley, but they bounced back by winning the league each time. Let's pretend the club wasn't relegated before. The difference is in 1961 they stayed down 4 seasons, in 1978 6 and in 1989 4. And down the road Sunderland haven't exactly bounced back, have they? And now, a brief interlude, while we hear from the late, great Hugh Masekela. Gave you a few notes on the slip, did he? Still wandering, Cardiff. The manipulated perceptions of Newcastle fans. Are you on his payroll as well? The man has lied through his teeth time and again and we've had enough. We still haven't broken our transfer record which was set over a decade ago. He's made a catalogue of terrible appointments. The list goes on and on. I've never read an article that is so off point. I always thought you were an awful journalist and this has just proved me right. Young Z85, London. You would have thought yourself right whatever I had written, mate, so I don't really care about that. As for bribery, put it like this, I always suspect people are projecting their own moral weaknesses when that topic arises. They think I must be on the take because they would be on the take, given my position. Of course I am paid to write, but that money comes from my employers, not from those I write about. I don't need Ashley's money, and I don't do favors. I write what I think, and I think criticizing a club owner for not breaking the transfer record is about as shallow and childish an argument as I have ever heard. Point 4, about Watford and their hapless owners. Hapless? Are you joking? Why do you think Watford fans love Gino Pozzo if that's the case? Why are Watford enjoying their third successive season in the top flight? Why have most of the top teams in the country been linked with their players who were signed for a fraction of the price others pay for their stars? The stadium has been updated, training facilities improved, they have even bought players who have appeared in Champions League finals. The finances are in great shape, the man has a degree from Harvard and he even paid for taxis to get fans to an away match when the coach broke down. Watford sit 10th in the Premier League and their owner sought fit to end a slide of 1-11 by appointing a coach with the credentials to organise the defence and stop them conceding sloppy goals before things got worse. That was done within 9 hours of Silver's dismissal. Hapless. Ben Thornhill, Watford. No, Ben, not hapless. That's not a word I would have used to describe the Pozzo regime. Indeed, it wasn't a word I used in the piece, and more people would have realized that had they bothered to read it, rather than just reacting to the headline. Anyway, as I've said here before, a headline is an attempt to capture the theme or mood of a piece, or its most salient or controversial point. The writer doesn't compose the headline. Sometimes, however, there is a disconnect between what the writer is saying and what the headline writer thinks is being said. This, I felt, was one of those times. When I saw the headline at 7:15 a.m. on Monday morning, I called our online desk and asked for "hapless" to be removed. I thought it implied Watford's owners were in some way incompetent or blundering and that wasn't what I was saying at all. The headline was duly changed online. My reading was that haplessness in this context equated in some way to incompetence. You must think this too, Ben, because you have listed a number of qualities the Pozzo family possess, all of which point to their competence. And I agree with those points. kept the club in the Premier Division, improved the stadium, bought better players at good prices, run a tight ship financially, lost the manager but moved fast for his replacement. Yet here is where it gets complicated. Haplessness, in its literal sense, has no bearing on competence. That's a modern interpretation. It has a single meaning, to be unfortunate, to be without luck. So the headline writer was correct in its use. In the sense of Watford's owners feeling sorry for themselves over losing Marco Silva, they are to some extent hapless. In the literal meaning, not our modern, perceived one. Because our modern, perceived one, mine, and yours, is wrong. So where does that leave us? Hung up on semantics. I can see both sides. Let's just say I do believe that making the manager's role disposable means any manager who gets the job will view Watford only as a stepping stone, as Silva did. And that was my point. So I stand by every word I wrote that day, except hapless, because that wasn't mine, although it wasn't strictly incorrect. This hapless owner is lauded by the Watford fans. This hapless owner has transformed a small club by using a continental model that the ignorant, old-school, cliched pressmen will never understand. This hapless owner has his own giant banner, produced by the fans, which fills one end of the ground on match days. This hapless owner has built a structure where a manager, head coach cannot hold a club to ransom, is simply another employee who can be replaced without destroying the club's structure. This Watford's fans understand, recognize and appreciate. Watford fans don't want a turnover of coaches, players or backroom staff, but if any of them fail to perform to the high standard set by a Premier League club, then they should be dismissed. The sooner these media dinosaurs retire and are replaced by writers who actually research articles, understand how football works in the 21st century and write accurately, the better for us all. Paul Kent, Canterbury. Well, I understood it well enough in 2012 when I wrote the column that preempted the changes the Premier League and Football League made to their rules to outlaw the Pozzo plan to flood the market with loan signings. I beat the game's administrators to that little realization by more than 8 months. Despite being ignorant, old-schooled and cliched, the people who ran football seemed to think I had a point in owning multiple clubs and moving players between them like pawns was no way to operate. You can read the column here. I've just glanced over it again, and I stand by it. Watford's success came after they were forced to change the initial strategy. They were forced to make the temporary permanent. I'm happy to have been ahead of that curve, Paul, and still am. As for this new plan, in which the manager cannot hold the club to ransom, don't kid yourself. The philosophy is that the Pozzos run the club to generate money and the manager cannot get in the way of that by introducing a philosophy of his own. I don't blame them, and it seems to be working quite well, but let's not pretend it is some higher plane or so sophisticated that confused old hacks can't appreciate it. Real managers are a nuisance to the modern owner managers. They stand in the way of sales, they want to make their own choices. That is why they are not empowered at Watford. It would run interference with the people in control. And it has worked for you, as fans, by gaining promotion and staying there for a change, so you love it. You have some good players, you see some good teams. But again, it's a marriage of convenience. There are no high standards as you put it in any meaningful sense. Watford's last two Premier League finishes are 13th and 17th. Now I might not understand how football works in the 21st century, but I'm pretty sure first is still first and 17th is nowhere. It's just good for Watford, that's all. Marco Silva's reign as Watford manager was ended by the owners last weekend, so what did they expect? Loyalty. He was passing through. Everybody is, at Watford. The manager, the players, so Watford should be loyal to the players and managers but not the other way around. It's okay for Silva to use Watford as a stepping stone in his career but not for Watford to use a manager to progress their club. What hypocritical tripe. Andrea Costa, St. Albans. Missed the point, didn't you? As Watford use their managers and dispense with them so casually, they will never find one who values loyalty. I'm not saying the whip hand should be on either side. But maybe had they shown more faith in their managers they would not get treated this way, or if they did, they would receive more sympathy at least, which seems to be what they are seeking. It really annoys you that Watford have done pretty well since your article about them being everything that's wrong with football, doesn't it, Samuel? EBC, London. Not in the least. Once the rules governing loans were changed, Watford's progress or otherwise ceased to concern me. I don't bear grudges. That's where we differ, isn't it? Watford needed those loan players as the owners had bought the club late on during the summer and there was too little time to buy good players. The club were on the verge of bankruptcy, so their squad was very small and the owners had two other clubs. It made perfect sense to use them to get loan players. MIB, Stockholm. Rubbish. They had finished a very respectable 11th the previous season, so did not need to recruit 14 loan players, including 10 from Udinese. They didn't need to sack Sean Dyche, either, which they also did that summer and I notice is not being mentioned in the eulogies. It's always the way. The media is obsessed with the top four. Everyone else is just there to shut up and release their players and managers on request to those clubs. Anyone that does anything different is apparently acting above their station. Sonic Boom 208, Southampton. Bit disappointed with that, Sonic, because you know I am all for smaller clubs resisting the pressure to sell. I've even discussed it with you on this forum as recently as August 2016, before the start of last season. Not much point me explaining further, or clarifying, if you just parrot the old clichés about the press disrespecting smaller clubs. I didn't argue that Watford had to release Silva to Everton. I just find it ironic that they are complaining about disloyalty, given the way they have jettisoned previous incumbents. Martin Samuel, king of the clickbait article. Just think, folks, they pay this guy obscene amounts to produce articles sourced from soundbites floating about on Twitter. Maybe he's not as dumb as he looks. Rob, London. But you most certainly are. Congratulations, Rob. You've picked probably the only journalist in Britain that isn't on Twitter. But I bet you will be. Meanwhile, the mystery of my absence, and that of many far smarter people, grows. Martin, there is a way for the Premier League and Football Association to stop this managerial merry-go-round, ban the mid-season sacking of managers. You finish the season with a manager you started with except under exceptional circumstances such as illness or sudden resignation. Also, no manager should be able to manage two Premier League or Football League clubs in the same season. Chase Wolf, Canuck. Look, Chase, my instincts are always against restrictions on football businesses running as they please. That applies to buying players. I wouldn't curtail transfers windows until April, like the old days, or changing managers. It is their coin, the business, and I don't think we should tell owners what is best for their club. Having said this, if there was a rule for managers that operates like a cup tie does for players, it would certainly have prevented Everton unsettling Silva. What if a manager was sacked, though, like Slaven Bilic and Mark Hughes? There would have to be grey areas in which the person could take another job. Point 5, lazy journalism, part 764, lazy journalism again, about Southampton selling to the highest bidder and it finally catching up with them. Yes, decent players have gone to Manchester United, Arsenal, Liverpool and Tottenham for decent fees, but you can't make a player stay if in his head he has already left for a bigger club. You just have to get the best deal. It's not as if they have sold players to Leicester or West Ham, is it? Onshore, Winchester. So Jose Font didn't leave Southampton for West Ham in the last transfer window. Lazy posting, was it, or maybe you just don't have a clue? Because it doesn't matter who you sell to, or how you try to justify it. Sell too many and it will affect your team, which has happened to Southampton this season. And now, the late, great Hugh Masekela meets Dexy's Midnight Runners via Mr. Andrew Weatherall. Predictably, no small amount of joy results. And not a Ugandan marimba in sight. Until next time.